every year, yeah, for $2, that shot and they can have.
And how much for grown-ups on the splash pad on a day like today?
I
My name's Ethan Underwood, some of y'all are old friends, some of y'all are some new faces. But I'm with the Lipscomb Johnson firm, and we are helping mortgage properties through this zoning application process. First, I want to apologize for a late start. I was in Atlanta all day and got to enjoy a two-hour commute back to Atlanta, but there was a bad wreck, so I apologize for just now being started. I promise we will be considerate of your time. If y'all would, we do have to report to the county folks who attended our meeting. I'm going to just pass them out, that way you don't have to come back up. I'll pass these out, y'all will sign in. And if y'all give us your email address, I promise we don't sell those either. What we will do is we will give you electronic copies of site plans, tax maps, and materials that we pass out to help us stay in touch with you. If y'all would just mind, it's a sign-in sheet. If you would mind helping us out. Thank y'all. Obviously, this is an application of interest, so we will answer any questions that you have. First, if you give about 5 minutes, I will present our presentation. With me, I saw Jim Morgans, who's with Morgans Property. There he is in the back room. He's actually the person who got his property under the application, and we can talk to you more about it. But just so y'all have a good bearing, see what the property looks like. It's a long thin track that's off the Knuckles Road. I know that it adjoins the orchards, which I've heard from a few friends over there. That's some concerns of what's coming. But the properties along Highway 20 are being developed in a fashion that is zoned as CBD, which is commercial business district. So this proposal is for commercial development. And what our goal was to try to work with y'all through this process is to make sure that y'all maintain your privacy. What we want to do is help these property owners to be able to use their land, but also to protect their privacy. We understand that y'all are there, and you don't want glaring lights and noise and all those kind of things from a commercial development. So if you're new to the zoning process, what we try to do is we work out and offer conditions of zoning that helps accomplish those goals. The track, I know that has been some issues that have been raised. You can see this kind of squiggly line is one of the boundaries because there's a screen that runs through the property that separates the properties. We have asked for some variances just because of the narrowness of the track in order to be able to use the property and access it. Copy of the site plan. We have to give this to illustrate the shape. This is Knuckles Road coming up this direction. And what we're proposing is a general commercial, which would allow for office or retail uses on the property. Frankly, the most likely use would be office, just simply because it's that far back. The closer to Highway 20 you get, the more likely retail users you would have. Getting off the road that far, it's not as prevalent, but we'd like to maintain that option. We are expecting this property at some point in the future, which is down to the south. Our client, Mr. Morgan, does not have it under contract. We don't have any rights to it. But just simply because we expect it will probably follow the trend of everything else is going CBD, we have asked for setbacks against that property as though with anticipation that one day it will develop commercial use. So with that, that's the general principles. We don't have any tenants lined up. We're not sure exactly who will be on that site, but we expect it to be developed for commercial at some point. So what we'd like to do is talk to y'all about your concerns, general things that we hear are people concerned about, what's the light spillage going to be. All this stuff is regulated by code, but we're here to answer questions and talk about anything from building facades to building size. And again, the intent is we want to let Mr. Morgans use the property in a profitable way. We're here to make a profit. We also want to make sure it's not affecting your quality of life. We understand that. So with that, Jim, do you have anything to add?
I don't have anything to
add. All right, come on up here and we'll see if you have questions.
Okay.
Yes?
Well, My name is Jim Fasano, and I'm representing several homeowners that have bought the property over in the Gates subdivision.
Okay.
And I want to make it clear that we are currently having a drainage issue problem, which we've rectified with an over $10,000 investment, which has directly been affected by this particular stream that runs in there. It runs through two properties over here, and as you notice something, there is nothing on the print that shows where this stream is running. That stream now runs through several properties, flooding this one particular property over here. It's a running stream. So the half of their yard is no longer functional.
We don't disagree. These lines are at the county. What we go through the process, the county delineates streams.
Mm-hmm.
So the county will go out and confirm this, but we don't disagree at all. This is a stream that runs through there just because it's not shown on the tax map. So,
well, I know that in your plan you have your detention pond located over here, and after suffering through what probably one of the worst years we've ever had, we've got several properties here. This particular stream right over here, which goes through the orchards right now, we have a complete failure of the drainage system here, a complete collapse of almost 80 foot of 60 inch pipe.
Wow.
So that cost us over $10,000 there. And another thing we're having a problem with right now is these streams all feed into Fall Creek and going across our runway right now. And right now in this area right here, we have severe damage that's being caused. In fact, we've got quite a bit of stuff that's not your concern, but we've got a lot of junk coming down from the highway feeding in here. So we find bottles and everything else in there that the neighbors have had to go in the stream and clean it up. So we are getting a lot of damage from there. So I'm assuming that any development in here, some guidance from drainage experts, is going to impact this whole community in here and impact the quality of water that's going into the Chattahoochee. So we do have some concerns here, and we need to voice it.
If I can, just so I know where everybody's from, how many folks here live in the Gates? Okay, how many folks live in the orchard of Habersham? Okay. Do we have any other folks? Is it
Vineyards.
And Wellstone.
And the Knuckles Homestead.
Okay, Knuckles Homestead. Well, just what I would invite y'all to do, we're happy to have y'all review these and go with you. But again, some folks are very schooled in this and some folks this is new to. What the county requires whenever you do detention, they will require, because frankly, there's no rooftops there. I mean, there's no asphalt there. So you say, well, where's all that water going? Right now it's being absorbed into the ground. What's going to happen to it? What the state regulations are and the county regulations, it requires that water be trapped and it run to the detention pond that's here. The detention pond just goes in the low spot. The water flows downhill. So it goes in the low spot. And that detention pond has to be designed so that it allows the water to settle out and it lets sediment, any oil that comes off the parking lot, because you don't want to be sending that stuff downstream. And the design of this, as far as your flooding is concerned, it has to be designed so that water flows out at a rate of 90% of the natural rate. So the things that are flowing down and flooding the Gates right now, they'll actually be detained. The water will still go down, but it will go down at a slower rate and will be meter. What I'd invite y'all to do, and I'd be happy to give y'all some numbers. If you want to call the county engineering department.
We've been in touch with them already because of the conditions that we're witnessing right now. So I think they're the development that's right over here, and I know that's a point of contention a lot of folks. When they developed this one, I'm sorry, I could have the wrong one. Okay, it could be this one right here. Isn't it this one right here?
Sure.
Okay. Well, what happened was when they graded this property, and right now they're regrading it, they have a berm that's set up over here. It has disturbed something because all of a sudden we're seeing a lot more water coming down. So we're going to contact the county and find out exactly what are they doing and how are they holding. There is nothing right now that we can see where they're managing that water run. Whether it's not runoff, it's all pervious surface right now because they didn't have anything. So we're having a problem now. Wait until they start paving. So, you know, we have to have a concern because it's money out of our pocket. It's a capital reserve problem.
Well, frankly, y'all have an overstorm system.
Yeah.
So we get that.
We understand. We've got two 60-inch pipes that go across that roadway, and that roadway has to be flooded over.
What we would want to invite anybody to do is to verify what the county, call the county, and if we're happy to meet with y'all on an individual basis with your neighborhoods to address your specific concerns. Stormwater certainly is important.
On that subject, yes, when this is just zoning, or when it's engineering, it's the county will make sure that it's designed as equal to the spot. And so it's to our interest to be able to help them, right? The county will make sure we get it done right. It's your interest to be.
Oh, absolutely. And we understand that that's going to be developed, and we're not concerned about that walk. We're concerned about the street and current conditions as it exists today, and what's going to happen tomorrow with the addition of improved services being put in there. Of course, like you said, 90% has got to flow out. That's going to put quite a burden on our existing tax system right now. And I don't know if the county ever signed
it's 90%. It's 90% of the existing maximum flow.
Okay,
so it's flowing there. Imagine the water will come out at for a longer period of time, but at a slower rate.
Okay, sir. Okay.
I'm Wendy, Radio Attorney. I represent the orchards at Habersham Grove Condominium Association, which many of you are here from. I'm not going to talk much about it. I just want to generally say that the Orchards Association has 88 homes, about 120 to 130 residents. The Neighborhood Association does have some pretty big concerns on the property. Essentially, you're taking what is a narrow, oddly shaped property next to a stream bed. And quite a bit of commercial development. One of the big issues is the amount of parking there. And it doesn't appear to be compliant with the county's comprehensive plan, which has the property suburban living. I asked a couple of the representatives of the HOA to bring their very specific questions. If we could do that, I'm going to introduce Keith Hexted. He's got some very specific questions. We thought that would be kind of a quicker way to handle the issues and get folks to know this.
Okay, thank
you. We were wondering what types of use are you contemplating for the property and what types of businesses?
Well, at this stage, I'm not trying to be evasive, but it is.
My question of Jim and Ethan was, what sort of businesses do they propose, and what are their plans for the development, business-wise?
We were trying to speak up. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. That's about as loud as I can get. At this stage, it's fairly speculative as to what precise uses will come here, what size businesses will come here. Our anticipation is these will primarily be offices, and given the location, it will primarily be small businesses, professional offices, accountants, and that's really about as far as I can go at this point in time.
There's a lot of
distance to go between now and when we actually get in construction underway, and market conditions would change. And
we are seeing a lot of medical office in the area, so the hope is something like that. As Jim said, professional office, maybe medical office, but there's not a tenant that's specified.
Okay, and I understand. And when we had Mr. Fields as a neighbor, he was a neighbor, and we had several of our residents have a fond relationship with him. And now, of course, not disparaging you or your company, but it's a corporation, and you're in this to make money, obviously. And we didn't know what you had proposed for it in your site plan. You're stating that 50% of the space is planned for retail, and it's our position that this is, according to the comprehensive plan, a suburban designated as suburban living, and you're going to stick retail right in the center of a suburban living zoned area.
It is, and let me answer that. As far as the comprehensive plan, the comprehensive plan is, it is a plan, but what it says is heavy, heavy, heavy commercial all on Highway 20. It's what's called a corridor, a commercial corridor. I'm trying to remember the exact term. But
the overlay?
In the future land use development. And then we have the Orchards, which is a Res 6, which is the highest density, highest, most intense residential unit we can get. So I would put forward to you that the comprehensive plan is doesn't quite work when it says heaviest commercial allowed in the county, low density housing between that and heavy commercial and the highest density residential. Probably somewhere in between might be a good, you know, something.
Ethan, could you just kind of go circle around the property and just hit with the property adjacent to the property where the zoning is right now?
Yeah, right now we have CBD, we have a Res 6 across the street, which is Wellstone at Middle Creek. We have an R2R, which is Vineyards. We have a Res 6, which is Habersham. And then we have the Orchards at Habersham, CBD, which is a development to the south of it, and then the Bennett property, which is right next door, is an R1. Now, just
the property directly across from the Orchards on Knuckles.
It's an A1. It's an agricultural zone. So we understand. We are certainly willing to work with everybody at the Orchards to try to alleviate the impact transition. If we know we're going to have heavy commercial closer to 20, and we know we've got residents back there, it makes sense to try to transition it down.
Okay, I guess my next question is for Jen, or you as well, Ethan. Is this going to be sold piecemeal? Are these going to be office condos? And will it have a property owners association? And the reason I'm going to ask the Property Owners Association is because of that detention pod, because it's an expensive proposition to take care of.
Hi. It's likely to go one of several ways. One, they could all be condominium. And if it is condominium, if it is office condominiums, then you would have a condominium association that would be responsible for the maintenance of all the exterior, all the buildings, all the grounds, the roads, the detention facility. It could go as individual sales to investors who build a building and rent. And in that case, you would have a property owners association, who are still going to be responsible for the common areas. I guess those are the two most likely. It would be very unlikely that we or anybody else would solely develop all those buildings. But if you did, then whoever owns that has to maintain all that property.
Okay.
So the maintenance, the long-term stewardship of the property will be handled.
Okay. I'd like to introduce Betty Pinna, who is one of our colleagues and one of our residents, and she too has several questions, please.
Okay.
We noticed in your plan that there is no easement for the sewer right now, and so we have a concern about whether anybody has checked whether that sewer it has the capacity to handle the additional development.
Capacity in the pipe or capacity to treat it?
To treat it and then the pipe.
The sewer line is shown to come through here. There's a connection on this property, right back in the back, the commercial property. So it will tack into a manhole back in this direction. This is the currently proposed route. Obviously that may be modified as buildings are moved or the final permit, but tie-in will be here. The capacity is, this is in the City of Cummings service area.
You don't have an easement right now. From looking at the plan, we did not see the easement is still to come.
I can answer that. That flows into, I'm sewer line flows into the sewer line that was constructed for the orchards. And there's capacity in the line, and there is plenty of capacity in the treatment. For treatment, they sell that capacity at $20 per...
No, capacity, I'm sure we have.
I would encourage you to contact the city of Cumming if you want to confirm that. But this is the location of where the sewer will connect. And then the
I think one of our questions is if you have an easement already, or you can promise an easement to be able to go into the property.
Yes. There is an existing easement that runs along through there. At least that's what we're told. Now that you bring that up, I think I'll double check that. Typically what the county requires is when you install a new sewer line that you provide easements for upstream properties to be able to access that sewer. So this is not going to be, I think there's an easement there, but if there isn't, we'll have to get one.
This is where it's showing. See, he already says it. It says 20-foot sanitary sewer easement through adjacent property tie.
It goes through the gates, and there is a 20-foot easement throughout that line. It follows Hall Creek all the way down to the pump station behind bus station.
Right. That's what our engineer tells me, anyway.
Yeah. Some of those dates.
We understand you're going after the CBD rezoning, and because you're talking about doing offices, you feel that O&I would have been very appropriate for you. This is the type of development you're going to have. In that case, if you're going to do office development and you follow the architectural standards that are in the Unified Development Code, one story that fits in with the adjacent buildings and the adjacent designs would be a lot more appropriate, considering we will be watching this.
Sure.
We will be looking at this every day, and so will other people that live close by.
You know something, did y'all hear the question? Miss Betty was proposing a different zoning category. We've asked for CBD, which is Commercial Business District. It's admittedly the most expansive commercial zoning category we have. And she had suggested, can you do office and institutional? The reason we didn't ask for that is office and institutional doesn't allow any retail. Now this may turn out to where when it gets developed, there is no retail. But what we don't want, can y'all still hear? We don't want to limit that possibility. Now something we've done to address that in the past is rather than say, okay, here's what you can do, why don't we all get together and say, here's what we don't want. We can certainly, we have what we call our no nasty zoning condition that says, okay, it's not going to be auto body shops, it's not going to be, there's the old Hooters one, that's a classic one. That might be supported more now than it was 10 years ago. But there's a standard condition that we would be happy to look at and talk with y'all that says there are certain things that we don't want. We know they generate a lot of traffic, but we're really not, at this point, able to say we really want to rule out any retail whatsoever. But we understand y'all are asking for a lot.
Well, the other issue is if you rezone office and institutional on that strip, if what comes forward on the other side is commercial development, be CBD, we still have a buffer. Otherwise, it can all be just...
I think that gets back to what we were talking about, transition.
Yeah.
You were saying if this gets zoned CBD, then you'd have an O and I in between to Res 6.
Which would become a transition, which is what you were talking about.
I don't disagree.
That is for real.
I agree. The only concern, candidly, is if somebody comes in there and says, hey, we do a little retail use, we're just hesitant to just totally block that out. But again, that's why we're here, to get your compliments or your comments and see what we can do to try to complement.
If you do office and institutional, you don't need as much parking, which is good because then you won't have as much impervious surface, means that your detention pond could be smaller.
You work for an engineering firm?
A long time ago.
I'm sorry.
What was the comment?
She said if we did all office and did the office and institutional zoning, we could do less parking, less impervious surface, smaller detention park.
And the other concern that I'm addressing is lighting, which you mentioned also. We would like to have the lowest possible lighting so we don't have light pollution in the neighborhood, and signage. We're very concerned about the type of signage that will be next to us. It should be in keeping with the area. And I understand that billboards are not signs, but we don't want to look at a billboard. Okay, and I understand they're not signs, right, but we don't want a billboard.
Well, so y'all know, can anybody hear the question about lighting? What's lighting going to do? The county ordinance says that at the road for a commercial development, the most you can have, Jim will have to submit what's called a luminescence report. So when he goes and he gets his permits, he's got an engineer who designs the lighting, and they have to determine what's the intensity of the lighting all throughout the site. The code says you can have no more than 2 foot candles at the road, but adjoining any residential property, you can have no more than 1 foot candle. A foot candle is literally the amount of light that a candle puts out at 1 foot away. So will there be some light? Yes. Will it be fairly dim? Yes. We worked with your neighborhood, I believe, on the Saab dealership, and I think y'all had some concerns about lighting. So let us go back and revisit that and see if that's something that Jim can work with as well.
Somebody mentioned half a foot candle.
Half a foot candle?
And I did have one more.
Before you go, the other question you had was, it was lighting.
And signage.
This is there is no variance allowed to the Forsyth County sign ordinance whatsoever. It is what it is. What this would allow is a monument style sign on Knuckles Road. I believe that the maximum height would be 12 feet in height, but there's a maximum square footage. I'll have to check. I get in trouble when I quote stuff from memory, but I think it's 32 square feet, which would be for everybody. That's not for like one tenant, that's for everybody in the center. So you may have what's called a kiosk sign where you have multiple users that have it out front, but it would have to be a monument type sign. Billboards are not allowed in the county. You have some grandfathered ones in that were built before they banned them, but they're banned now, so no more billboards. All you can do would be a monument sign.
Okay. And my last one, we are very concerned about the kind of traffic that it could become, a throughway traffic through this property to the Midas Muffler property. And then we're going to have a lot of traffic going in and out of there. And there even could be later on traffic from that property into Highway 20 as a shortcut. People like to do that. And we're very concerned because there is a lot of traffic on Knuckles Road, especially in that whole corner. And that corner is a high accident area.
Yes, we can't deny it. That's crossed our minds, and frankly, we think it would make it safer. I know nobody likes more traffic than what you're already experiencing now, but the way this sets up, y'all have a traffic signal here, and I know we've heard from a lot of friends say, we really need a right turn lane out there. It needs to be pulling out there because everybody's stacking up, and people take weird chances trying to make turns. But because this traffic light is so close, my understanding, I think you do have a median cut there, don't you?
There is a median cut down here, yes.
Okay, so there is a median cut. These folks could take a left turn. They could make not just a right in, right out, but they could make a left turn out of that development. But those folks are probably thinking the same thing y'all would. They say, wow, it's a whole lot safer to drive up here and go to a traffic light than it would be to brave at least 3 lanes of traffic, maybe 4, to make a left turn. We think that GDOT would probably think, hey, that's not a bad idea to be able to get as many folks to that traffic signal as possible. We are working, and I'd encourage y'all to do the same, to talk to the engineering department in the county and say, hey guys, if this gets approved, what road improvements are gonna be required out here at the intersection? There's certainly gonna be a right-hand turn lane for folks that turn in here and they have to decelerate. But we're looking to see what, if any, improvements would have to be done out of this area. But I understand it. Nobody likes more traffic, but
we think it would make it a safer situation if these folks did ask to come across there, that they come across there and be able to use the light. Yes, sir.
Jim Simon from the Vineyards. I've got a couple questions for you. First one, the point of entry to this property in relation to the interest of the Vineyards. Mm-hmm. Show what that is. And second, could you explain the zoning change process in which you actually have to do that zoning change?
Please? Sure, sure. The county likes teed up intersections. So what they've asked for the intersection is to actually line up with Bordeaux Boulevard. You don't want an offset street where you've got one street coming in here, one street coming in here, and you've got all these conflicting turns, people hit each other. So they want them to line up directly so that everybody's stopping at the same intersection. So as part of the conditions, that will have to be lined up with the Bordeaux Boulevard. What was section, the process? The process is, we're meeting with y'all. And obviously there's a lot of folks in this room, and we want to make sure everybody leaves tonight with all accurate information. You sleep on it, and you say, hey, maybe I forgot to ask something, or maybe you got more neighbors that couldn't come tonight. We want to get your input. So we'll take your input, and we will develop a set of zoning conditions that we submit to the county that says, okay, we're asking for a particular zoning, but here's what extra we'll do above and beyond the county development code. We submit that to the county, and it goes to the county planning commission. We are planning to go forward, I believe it's on July 22nd, is the meeting before the planning commission. The planning commission makes a recommendation to the board of commissioners. And then once it goes through that process, the planning commission is a public hearing, so anybody can get up and speak. And then at the board of commissioners level, it goes about 30 days later, the board makes a final decision. So we're looking at having a final decision, moving along the process, of the Thursday in August. But what we'd like to do is, you know, obviously try to get as many folks at least not objecting to the application as possible. Yes, sir.
What other property has this gentleman developed? As an example of what we might anticipate.
We have a shopping center over in Woodstock. And it's kind of Wiley Bridge Village. In town, we've got some residential subdivisions that were some time ago developed. Those are the ones that are, other than the residential, I'm relatively new to the commercial business. So we have one shopping center over in Woodstock and land for an office building when the Great Recession finally recedes.
What is the name of that?
I'm sorry?
What is the name of that?
It's Wiley Bridge Village. Yes, ma'am.
I'm Carrie Hamilton. I live in the Vineyards. Why this property? It seems like such a bizarre place to shove in it just feels like a large project to shove in such a small 4 acres. And when you drive around I understand what you're trying to do here. There's so much other property that doesn't sit so close to neighborhoods, and so I'm concerned about that because I actually am the first house in the Vineyards, and we already have a lot of traffic. Mm-hmm. I'm concerned about returning in and out, the safety. I have a young child. We have a fence around our yard, but still, that's concerning. Privacy is a huge concern of mine. The lighting, if you get as far as developing it, when they developed Wellstone, the dust was insane. My house, I had just had it painted. It was orange because of all of the dust from the red clay. Talk about being completely irritated by that. So what your plan is to keep the dust down, because now this orchard is going to be affected by that as well. That was not, they weren't there when they developed. We're starting to keep all of that clear. So I'm really, really concerned, and I guess why this property?
Is this you right next to the tennis courts?
No.
I'm the very first house when you turn into you. I'm across the street. I'm on Knuckles. It is on my side of my across the street. So I'm really, really concerned about
what this is. To try to address the why question, there was a lot of questions in there.
I know, but I'm hearing you're concerned about how this does personally affect me that I'll look at.
To address the why question, in case you haven't noticed, there's a lot of activity going on along Highway 20.
Sure, yes.
And the Bennett's property is right, and it's just right at the muzzle of the shotgun. And I don't know what's going to happen, got nothing to do with it, they have no interest in it.
I know very well.
But something's going to happen there. So in terms of, well, that's part of it. Another part of the question, the answer is, in my business, things are kind of opportunistic. The land is available. That's one reason why. And we're probably a little ahead, but we aren't proposing to do anything that's not going to happen in the next 2 years, whether we do it or somebody else does it. Because the Bennett's, I can't say for sure, but I would bet a lot of money that the Bennett's property does not stay R1 and developed into single-family homes.
Did you say,
I'm
going to clarify this, because I don't know that we all know this. Is there a proposed road to this property from Highway 20?
No.
Okay, so the only access point to this property that you're proposing to develop is off of that one.
We don't want to rule out.
Listen, we're on board now, right?
That was what Miss Betty had asked, and we don't want to rule that out.
Yeah, you could talk about that on number 20 and the property.
Do you own that other property that is adjacent to get to 20? This
moment? I am an investor in that property.
Okay.
That
would really, really concern, I think, most people here. Yeah, so the traffic, it won't make it safer. That road, people are already driving very fast. It's a cut through. You lose saw views it now for their test drives.
Yep.
That's been a huge addition to traffic.
That's like what we're doing is not having to do with lose saw.
You know,
even if there is a connection.
Well, I'm just adding the traffic volume on the road because it's a lot. I've lived here 13 years.
Right.
And there was not a whole lot. We anticipate improvements. I get that. But I'm just very, very concerned about what it's all going to look like across the street from our neighborhood. Is that sign, is it going to look like something on Sanders Road where they have very nice signage? And that is across the street from Underwood there. Is that kind of a building style that you're thinking of? It's brick over there to go along with the nature of the other homes and things?
We haven't done any architectural decisions, but I can tell you that from a personal standpoint, I like to have something that looks pretty good. I like to be able to take my wife out and say, "Don't you like that?" And she's pretty picky. And also from a competitive standpoint, in the marketplace that's out there today, if it doesn't look good, it won't rent. So from a personal and a business standpoint, we will do what we think looks good. I can't guarantee you you would think it looks good, but it's more than likely going to be hard surface siding, hard surface exterior walls to the buildings. You'd want an attractive sign out front. You'd want an attractive entrance that has its landscape nicely. The other entrances that are along there to the other communities, all are nicely done, and they're nicely done for a competitive reason. If you don't do it nicely, it's just not going to work.
Yes, ma'am, you're done.
So when I look at the zoning application on the county website, mm-hmm. It says that this is a request to rezone 4 acres for office development. What I'm hearing now is the request is to rezone it to just commercial and then we'll decide what to put in there based on what we can sell or something. Is that a
fair
statement?
Yes. We apply for central business district zoning.
I'm looking at what we filed, and that is, it looks like someone hand-wrote that in. I'll check on that, but the site plan specifically states, and I understand that, so thank you for bringing that to our attention. But the site plan specifically says two-story office slash retail. So we're telling y'all we'd like the ability to use retail. Likely, that's not what it, it's one of those things you say, well, you're telling me likely. Likely, just our experience, commercial property that far off the major highway, you just don't get a lot of retail, but you might get some.
But I'm assuming if you connect to that adjoining property and have a pass through that adjoining property,
and there is no current plan to do that. Something we wouldn't want to rule out, that it would never happen in the future. And matter of fact, most planners would encourage what they call interpersonal connections, so you don't have a lot of dead ends.
But realistically, can I say that it could just as easily be a Jiffy Lube as an office? You know,
so you're asking that it not be a Jiffy Lube?
I'm not trying to be cute.
That's the kind of stuff I hear.
Or cookie bar,
right.
Professional
building. Okay. And that's the kind of thing I was talking about, saying, well, why don't we come up with a list of things we don't want to do? And that way we say, okay, here's what's okay, but we certainly don't want certain things.
We don't want retail. We don't want retail. No retail.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Carolyn Ruffles Baker. I have lived in the same area since 1940, my family has. And I would like to say that Ruffles Road cannot handle any more traffic. That's because I can hardly get out of my driveway now.
Where's your driveway, ma'am? Miss Baker was saying that she's... Knuckles Road can't handle any more traffic. She can't get out of her driveway. Here's Knuckles. It runs right up.
Okay. I am right here.
Okay, so you.
A1.
Okay, that's
yours. Okay. A1. I still have 2 acres. And it's impossible almost. There are trucks going through there, and the rest of the people who live on that road. There is no other thing other than homes from there until you get to Beaver Dam Road. Trucks and everything else.
What kind of trucks?
Semis, really? Dump trucks and whatever go cutting through the road, and it is not wide enough and not sturdy enough. And they already took a half acre of my father's land for the road. I don't think you should have any more commercial traffic on that road, because it's very busy and they're all homes from there until you get to go with the damn road. Thank you.
So are you concerned? So what would y'all suggest that this be done?
Nothing.
Because it's not surrounded, it's on the edge of residences.
There's a house on the other side of your property that you want to put.
I'm sorry, ma'am, I can't hear.
There are two houses on the other side of that commercial property that you want to build. They're residential.
They're here?
Yeah. And you first turn off the Knuckles Road off the top. Right. There are two residential houses.
Right.
There. It is residential. So how are you going to put the commercial license in those residential? I'm happy.
Well, that's what can be developed. If it's zoned for a commercial use, or if it's zoned for residential use, people have a right to do something with their properties. So, y'all are saying it needs to be residential, but it's the type of residential, it's wedged between a res 6 and heavy commercial. So, I would submit to you, it's either going to be res 6 or heavy commercial or something in between.
Well, there's property where they're located. Is it George Town? Mm-hmm. How much property is available?
It really doesn't matter, because what the law says is this person has a right to do something with their property, and it's something besides being zoned agricultural.
Is this legally blind out yet now?
No, it's under contract.
Okay.
But is it subject to then?
I'm sorry?
Is the closing subject to rezone?
Of course. Sir,
there you go.
Sure.
All right.
Yeah.
But I just
want
to, I heard you say that it's next to commercial. By that argument, anything that touches commercial is therefore
entitled
to commercial. I mean, it's, you know, just...
There's a corridor that's shown on Highway 20 that says, this is, I mean, it's Highway 20, it's a four-lane major road. It is the de facto connection between 75 and 85. It just is. So, this is... But it makes sense. I understand y'all asking the transition because we understand there's residences here. We get that. I get that. But you're right. Does it mean you put heavy commercial right next to residences? No. But you try to feather it down or transition it down. Yes, ma'am.
We have 97 families in the Vineyard subdivision, and quite a few of those have children.
So y'all go right by the O and I and the CBD on Highway 20 all the time anyway. Or I'm sorry, here.
No.
I'm sorry, you come up. That's the gates. The vineyards. But again, if y'all are walking through here, I mean, this is zoned as heavy a commercial as it gets.
Well, it's on Highway 20.
It's on Highway 20.
You are on Highway 20.
Well, it's not terribly far.
No.
So what's the spot?
Put it on 20 so all shop at your stores.
So what are y'all suggesting is the use for?
Residential.
And agriculture?
Residential is fine. It's a residential area.
But
it's not commercial.
Yes, sir.
I have a question about the road replacement.
Yes, sir.
Are you going to have to ask for a variance on that because it's too close to the creek that runs through there?
You don't have to ask for a variance for roads over streams. You can cross streams for roads.
Yeah, but you're not crossing it, you're parallel.
Any kind of road improvement is exempt from stream buffers. Now,
you had to line up with the other road across the street.
That's right.
You do that, are you too close to the street?
No. The answer is no, and the answer is also it wouldn't matter if it was.
Okay.
We have asked for a buffer variance in the back part of the property. But as far as the access road goes, we are outside of the 75-foot impervious surface setback. But even if we weren't, if you needed to put an access road through that area, you could do it without any variance. But.
So what do you do with the water that runs through here?
The water that runs through there? At this point, the water is going to continue to run through there. So we're not asking to pipe any streams.
Not to blacktop the property because the water is going to run off of that creek.
Well, no. What happens is the stream is going to keep going the way it does. And you clear what we're showing is we've asked for a 50-foot impervious surface setback. So that means you wouldn't have any asphalt within 50 feet. You curb it. So any rain that hits on that is going to be directed into some drop inlets. So rain that's falling on the creek right now goes straight into the creek. Rain that's falling on the grass, on the field, or the trees, it goes right where it does. But where you put pavement, it's trapped on a curb, and then the water is directed to drop inlets that then run it out to the detention pond where it holds it and then meters it out.
That's what they thought at Sanders Road also.
Which one's Sanders?
The dam road.
I know where Sanders Road is, but what development are you talking about?
I'm talking about a dam that broke that they haven't fixed in about a year. The guy said the same thing, the water will run through the dam and into Lake Bennett.
Well, it's exactly the same engineering. The design would be different because the design of each one of these things.
That dam was 80 years old, and unfortunately, when things are 80 years old, they break. But this is.
Well, careful.
But that's. When dams are 80 years old, sometimes they break.
The point I'm trying to make is the engineering that will go into this detention pump is exactly the same kind of engineering. It may be a little more sophisticated as time has passed, that went into the design of a detention pond that detains the orchard's stormwater.
So far that's worked, okay, correct.
And so far that's worked.
I'm having a hard time with lots of people.
What I'm trying to tell you is I've seen water in that creek probably 4 or 5 feet deep. Mm-hmm. And that's not the 100-year plus. So, you know.
What I would invite y'all to do, and we tell folks, Jim has a financial interest in knowing where all that water goes. And then we talk to neighbors.
You, I live right next to it.
Y'all do too. So verify with the county. Go to the county and say, hey, what's this going to do if this gets approved? Well, we encourage you to go ask those questions. Yes, sir.
You're interested in continuing to pursue the purchase, even though it is conditional. The staff has already given a non-supportive position. Mm-hmm. What concessions are you making, or what did they require of you that you were not in? Even if you've given in, what is some of those things that you now are willing to continue to pay the price for? To move this through now the political process, which this is the system of which you went through the county already, they have said, nope, we're not supportive. So what concessions were they asking? Now that you're continuing to invest in it, what is it that you're willing to give into the political process as well?
As far as the planning, same comments that we're getting out of folks at the orchards were saying it needs to be a lesser intensity.
This is the staff saying a bigger easement, a bigger, what do you call it, berm? What are they asking?
They're fairly vague, and what I would encourage you to do is you go ask them. Be candid with you. They weren't quite clear with it.
We're not too sure what the staff wants.
But they turned you down.
They turned down a request for CBD. They said they weren't supportive of the request for CBD. Because they thought, candy, let's look at it. CBD, if I were to build a movie theater, I'd go zone to CBD. Now, you and I know you can't fit a movie theater on this shaped property. It's too funny shape, you couldn't do it. But in theory, you could do it. In theory, you could do a 5-story building. Jim's not proposing that, so what we do is we come in and we say, okay, we'll cap the number of stories. We can negotiate minimum requirements of green space. We can negotiate caps on impervious surface. Those are the kind of things that we can do to say, we'd like to be able to use certain uses, but we'd like also, we're willing to mediate it to lessen the impact.
Ethan.
Let me ask.
This is actually regarding, okay. You had mentioned earlier that there was a turnoff. It's not on these points.
What do you mean a turnoff?
You said a slowdown lane.
Right.
Deceleration.
No, there is none. And so there's not enough land unless you're taking away from your land to do that.
I think you're talking about a turn lane.
A turn lane. And that will certainly add, if there is no turn lane, a huge potential for backup and accidents. Because that is turning into, there's already people turning into our neighborhood that almost landed behind me.
Yeah.
Because people aren't paying attention. So. There is not one on this plan that is submitted to the county.
Well, what we have to do, we do have to resubmit. After these meetings with neighbors and we get comments, we submit another application to the county, which is called an application for board consideration. which says, okay, we're going back with the comments that we get from neighbors. You know, what the engineering department asked is, owner developer shall dedicate right-of-way 40 feet from the center line of Knuckles Road as part of site development or when required for road improvement projects as required by the Department of Engineering. So I'm sorry. My experience is that usually they require a deceleration lane.
Yeah.
It's ordinance 101 is what requires that.
Because we have an acceleration lane on our side of Knuckles, right?
Let me check on that. Thank you for bringing that to my attention. Yes, sir.
Two other points. One is, would you consider not having an entrance exit on Knuckles Road? Do it all on 20.
So are you saying no entrance on Knuckles whatsoever?
Yeah. You at the bottom end down there, can you not get up onto 20?
No, it is not showing an access point. We said we don't
want to
rule it out, but it's not
shown.
Ethan.
Well, what I'm suggesting is, would you look into that?
So you said no access on the nut.
Yeah, right.
And then access out here. We'll look into it, but from a safety standpoint, it makes sense to go to a light.
I understand. Just,
they put that light in there because that's a major commercial area.
There's a better chance of getting a second light on 20 than there is on Knuckles Road at your entrance.
There will not be asking for a light on that.
I know you're not, but we live there and there are kids there. The corner property is a swimming pool. There's all kinds of young little kids running around all over the place there. The first time a car comes over that hill and that kid runs out into the street, you've got a major problem, possibly a death. I think you need to take all of that into consideration.
Ethan, listening to what you said earlier, you are considering a throughway between Knuckles and 20.
We're not ruling that out. We're not considering it.
Have you not requested the authority to do that?
I'm sorry?
Have you not requested the authority to do that?
We've not requested the authority.
Standalone
project. He had asked, are you going to punch through and access onto this? And we said, we don't want to rule it out. We've had this gentleman say, we want you to rule this out. We want you to go straight through 20. But at this point, it's a standalone project.
Would you consider that?
How far is
that?
This gentleman's name.
I've got a couple of questions.
Yes, sir.
One is, I couldn't hear, did you say you had a in that property down on 20 at the other end of the field?
Yes.
Property?
You have there is a meeting right here.
So you will have some influence on whether that's approved or not back out on the 20.
Some influence, but I don't much.
Second part, Ethan.
Yes, sir.
You're taking all these comments and you said you will submit those to the planning group. Will you provide any input back to the folks that are here prior to you doing that like you did with Lou Saab?
Absolutely. We're happy to meet with y'all again. What we would do is, those of you who gave us an email address, we'll send you a site plan, we'll send you a copy of this tax map, so send it to your neighbors if they have any questions. And what we do is, from this meeting, we develop a set of zoning conditions. And we'll blast those out to folks, and we certainly be happy to come speak with y'all and ask for your input and comments and see if it's something that's done to get you comfortable that's something at least you could not oppose the application. Yes, sir.
What is your timeline for this project?
As far as when do you plan on breaking ground?
Well, first of all, we don't have a timeline.
Okay.
The reason we don't have a timeline is we don't have zoning.
Right.
So we don't know what we could do.
Okay.
So until we can figure out what we can do.
Best case scenario, what would you like? What would you hope for?
Best case scenario is that by the time this one wins its way through the process, Ethan's talks about this third week in August. I think that might be optimistic that it happens.
You mean to go before the commission?
Right.
By the time we get, we're trying to get engineering done, by the time we decide what it is exactly that we're gonna do, my guess is it's towards the end of 2015 before there's any ground, maybe early 16. But that's a guess. It also depends a lot on what the economy does. I mean, if the economy continues to improve the way it looks like it is, then that's probably pretty realistic. If it has a hiccup and slows down again, which some people think it might do, then that's not realistic. Is that responsive?
Yes, thank you.
Yes, sir.
I live in Orchards, and a couple questions I have. Has a site elevation plan been developed for this project?
No.
You don't have anything developed to where the parking lot's going to be in relation to the street, the paved road?
Like a cross section?
Correct.
What's the elevation?
You're asking?
Site elevation.
Elevation?
Yes.
We can, in fact, if you look at the site plan, they're very faint. There are topographic lines on here. But you want to see what a finished grade is?
Correct.
Yes.
No, and we'd have to ask our engineer if he has an idea what that would be. But candidly, all that stuff is usually, the zoning says, okay, here's what you can use it for. Once it's zoned, then you go engineer. It's not been engineered, but we could get some rough estimates.
Well, we could get some rough estimates. The problem with doing rough estimates on grading and building elevations and all that sort of stuff, is even if I call them rough estimates, all of a sudden they acquire they become real.
Okay.
And I'm very hesitant to do that at this point in time. I've never seen anybody do these kinds of engineering and architectural studies prior to even knowing if you can get it zoned.
But one thing is that the elevation level of Knuckles Road is significantly higher than this property.
Yes.
I mean, it is a major drop down to the property.
Down. That's true. That's true.
So there's got to be a grade coming from Knuckles Road to there, so that's going to push those buildings back at some time. If you want to have all of that parking that you're requesting.
On a conceptual level,
right.
Our engineer tells us that this works. The road will generally follow, the grade of the road will generally follow the grade that's out there. Now there'll be some side-to-side grading so that you get a flat road because the land obviously slopes up from the creek.
Well, that's a concern, to flow to the creek. Is this road going to be higher, lower?
No, it'll be higher than the creek.
Right.
For sure. It's going to be 75 feet, I think it's 75 feet off the creek. So it will be higher than the creek, but there won't be any storm drainage that comes from the road to the creek.
Okay, question, I guess, which we've experienced, and I think one of the residents have some pictures, relative to rainfall. During heavy rainfall, the runoff in the stream area flows to the top of the ditch. Has an actual study been done on heavy rain runoff?
No, what has to be submitted, again, post-zoning, it's what's done, it's called a hydrology study.
Right.
And that's probably the most scrutinized and one of the most expensive things Jim will get to do, is pay engineers to do a hydrology study, then he gives it to the county, and their engineers review it and make sure that they agree with it. But they have to account for not only what happens to the rain on this site, but what happens downstream as well.
Right. I'm sure he's concerned.
Yes. I have a question about the traffic. I'm Linda back at the Millstone. We have no earthly idea how many offices will be in each building, do we? And do you know what the density is of your
on a rough square footage, on a rough basis, this is just a conceptual plan for zoning purposes only. I
The median looks like that's about 40,000 square feet total of sales office condos.
Right, but in each building, do you know how many businesses will be housed in each building?
Well,
so that we can even judge how many.
We don't, because what may happen.
People will be coming daily.
You're right. We've asked for 40,000 square feet, but what may happen is you get a bunch of doctors and say, hey, this is great, we want this to be an office condominium. So we want you to split this up into six different units per pod. Or you may have one person who comes in and says, you know what, I make candy. I've got a catering business, I make cupcakes and candy. I want to go, you know, back here, and it's 110. We don't know. We just don't. So the only thing we can show to you is what we're proposing, a square footage of building. But what
so
happens?
All of this will impact the number of cars that come in. Now we can't possibly know how this is going to impact our neighborhood. Is there a traffic study done by the county after you have jumps? I mean, are you going to, how will we know how we're going to be impacted?
The county will, when we get final building permits that come in, the county says, okay, based on the use that's coming in here and the traffic that's estimated based on ASHTO, which is the American Association of Highway Officials, ASHTO standards, they'll say this, we anticipate it's going to generate X. If it crosses a threshold, they may require a traffic study. At this point, they're not required. Who's next? Yes, ma'am.
Does the commercial zoning allow for manufacturing? Because some manufacturing does emit some pretty horrible odors.
No, that manufacturing, no, what you would do, that would be what's called M1 or industrial zoning. This allows for retail, and it allows for baking. You could do baking, but it would not be any type of industrial manufacturing.
And then back on the traffic question again, if this property cuts through to that other commercial property,
some buildings? Yeah, it will. It will be heavily landscaped, but it will probably only come out to about here just because you have to have adequate sight distance coming out of that.
Well, and there's a difference in being reasonable and not being, you know, and that's really what we're talking about here. And then the other side is we would ask for that all the way up the road, no matter what you need. They get that up. And that intersection between has got more work to be done than what
is there a potential for us to do the plan for the rest?
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
He brings up a buffer along Knuckles Road. I'm living in a condo that overlooks this piece of property.
Right.
So I'm very concerned. I know there's a question up here that's going to come up. But I'm very concerned about the buffer because there's two condos, four units, that overlooks this little piece of property that's not protected by any tree barriers or buffer barriers or anything, because we've got an undisturbed buffer to the center line of the ditch. So my interest is, what kind of buffer foliage are you going to put along there to protect us from all the traffic, two-story buildings, etc., that's going to grow and protect us and not pine trees, because they fall over like large magnolias or something like that, spaced accordingly where they will protect us.
Well, I think what we have to look at is one, there's going to be landscaping that has to be done on the side. So you have landscape islands and whatnot, and that helps gym the cell and makes it more attractive. But two, as we said, there's a stream that runs between y'all. We have asked for a variance on one side of the stream. But what the county ordinance says is you have to leave a 50-foot buffer, no grading, no anything, no planting. So if you've got other pine trees in there, we got to leave it.
they also say that if the adjoining property owner agrees, you can put plantings in that undisturbed buffer.
I don't think we can in stream buffers, probably.
We'll let you come over on our property on the undisturbed buffer.
We'll talk to the county about that, but what we've got is you have 50 foot on one side, and then you got 50 feet on the other side. So you have a 100-foot buffer that can be graded, can't be changed.
We have
asked to reduce that on one side. So you, instead of a total of 100-foot buffer, you have a 90-foot buffer.
But there will be plantings there.
If it has to be supplemented. But again, Jim can't go in that stream buffer without a variance. So it's possible that the county says, no, we don't give you a stream buffer at all. A stream buffer variance at all. So with that, you end up with a 100-foot buffer, and Jim can't do anything to it. He can't grade it, he can't plant it, it just is what it is. We can certainly, let us get back with the county. I'm trying to see what kind of a tree. It looks like there is some trees that are running along it, but there's a clear spot next to it. Let me talk with the county, but my understanding is Jim can get in big trouble for going in there without permission to do that. So let me check on what he can do.
Those trees are deciduous trees. So in the fall, six, 7 months out of the year, it's bare there. So mm-hmm. We would see everything, every bit of your buildings there. So it definitely needs to be a very thick, fast-growing evergreen.
And Ethan, as I'm sure you know, the UDC prescribes the type of vegetation that can be put in there.
In buffers.
Right.
And when I say a buffer, it's saying like, my neighbor's over here, he don't want to see what I'm doing, he don't want to see what I'm doing, I don't want to see what he's doing. So you can put buffers, but when you're dealing with streams, it's a totally different ballgame.
Okay, but what we're telling you is, from the project's perspective, we will give you permission to plant on our property.
Thank you.
Reasonably, to make a permanent maintained buffer, maintained in perpetuity for the benefit of creating that buffer.
Let me check with the engineering department to see what they'll let us do, and then once we get that answer, that tells us which direction. Yes, sir.
I kind of always believe a little bit about using the written word rather than the verbal word. It's hard, easy to keep track of these. And we've talked a little bit about uses. And in this book, or this map, which is a copy of what you've got, one of the statements in here that I assume was authorized by the owners is that it is assumed that 50% of the building usage will be for retail use.
Mm-hmm.
And is this a document then that's done a great job of designers at? And when I see that, I begin to feel like that's something that's going to be there. And I just wonder, do you go back at any time and correct some of these
From what I'm hearing from everybody here, I think, yeah, we'll probably have to go back and correct some of this stuff.
Somebody got a message.
But so yes, this is our initial application. This is what we say, here county, here neighbors, here's what we'd like to do. And now we're getting feedback from that. We have to submit another plan that says, okay, in light of that, here's what we'd like to do. And I mean, candidly, we're going to submit something we feel we can get done. And I'm hearing y'all saying no.
Thank you.
We're listening.
Wes, and let me just one
follow-up
comment on that. I didn't want to follow that. Based on what you said a while ago about how this development process, and you had different ownership than they have. Based on how it's zoned, they can do anything they want under that zone. So whether it's your intent initially to come in here with that, or whether it ends up in somebody else's hands, they can change that whenever they want to based on the zone that's assigned initially. So that's a real concern.
Well, actually, when the zoning goes through with conditions, the conditions run with the land, and any subsequent title owner lives with those same conditions.
It's like a cut.
Well, I hear you.
Well, we hear that. It would have to go through another public hearing. So let's say, I'm making it up. Let's say we get this zone CBD. I know I'm being optimistic. Let's say we get zone CBD. And we put this no nasties provision in there that says there won't be a Hooters.
You're going to be in trouble. You're
going to be in trouble. We could come back and say, and then Hooters comes in and says, this is the perfect spot.
They pay high rent.
The only way you get a Hooters is if we go back to the Board of Commissioners. And I would expect we'd probably have a crowd about three times this big since we don't want a Hooters. So can conditions be changed? Yes. Do they have to be approved by neighbors and commissioners? Yes. So what we're trying to do is we want to walk. My goal is try to walk in there holding hands with y'all as best we can at this meeting. That's what we'd like to do.
And I think the response to that is to go over and I don't have to worry about any of
it. Well, at least from your neighbor. I'm hearing some other folks. Yes, sir.
I don't mean to speak officially for the mention, but I've talked to a lot of people in the meeting, and I say that Ken's right on what he's saying about that. If it is left for a Michelin retail, I think the Michelin vendors are going to be absolutely 100% opposed to it and look at all of that.
I've got it, I promise.
Ethan,
yes, sir.
Has there been any consideration to putting a fence between the properties to prevent walk through between foot traffic between your proposed development and our neighborhood?
You're in the orchard, right?
Yes.
Remember, that's a pretty good slope going out from the creek to the...
In some places. Yeah. Not everywhere. It was just a question.
Yeah. We not consider
it? Never occurred to me because it looked like it looked pretty steep to me.
Not as you get closer to Knuckles.
It flattens outside.
Okay.
It's in the notes. We'll talk about it here too. Do we have any other questions we haven't addressed? Well, thank you all for giving up.
I just want to do real quick, I think you knew this already, but I just want to do a quick show of hands, or you can stand or raise your hand, if you currently object to the rezoning as it's been presented to date, what you're calling the initial application.
Yes.
You notice we were quiet about it.
You all were exceedingly quiet. I appreciate that. Do we have any other questions? Thank y'all for coming. We will be in touch with you very shortly, and we appreciate your time.
Thank you, folks.
Thank you.
You're going to
be successful.
It's a nice.
We went through the same thing they did the CBD over here, but I think they made a horrible mistake. What they did was, man, this one here was a public intention. These people here didn't even get letters when this was done. There was a public intention. And the gentleman
I would think if I'm a business owner, I've been in suites like this, I wouldn't want a lot of cars going back and forth there anyway. Doctor's office, lawyer's office, something like that. You only want to support it. So I think you plan the way it sits.
Well, that's why.
It looks good. It looks good. I wouldn't even consider this as being part of it at all. I don't think it's necessary. But we just had this problem right here in this corner here. We've got to figure out what we're going to do. We'll talk to the county about this. Because right now, it crosses over here. Yeah, it crosses over here. And what's happening is it's flooding this yard right in here. It floods this whole thing. So this is not accurate at all.
This one is covered.
And I know what you're doing here. You've got your detention pond, and this is your head wall. Right?
Right.
And of course, the head wall is probably going to have a dry creek of some sort to allow it to naturally flow out to the creek.
It would have, yes.
Where's the creek itself? The creek is out over towards here, isn't it?
These arrows?
This is the center line, right?
These arrows.
Oh, okay.
The creek.
Yeah, okay. So that's your creek. So your head wall, you'll probably have some dry creek, some riprap, and get it out there.
That's right.
Yeah.
And it will not, basically, it won't impact this stream.
No. This would have to fill up. This would have to fill up too, like you said. Fill up 100% will allow probably 10% of it to start flowing in. It's metered.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's metered with the head, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Well, it's metered in the, not in the sense of...
No, I mean, you're going to get all the flow. It's going to come in here and it's going to fill up and it's going to start spilling over. So you're just going to capture it. Well, this does have an elevation that goes down, so it's going to run fast.
What happens is
you've got inlets. It looks like droppings all along.
These are inlets.
Yeah, and this will be the inlet to the pond itself.
You get a big inlet, and you get a small outlet.
Yeah.
And the small outlet is designed to small enough hole.
It's restricted. It self-restricts.
So exactly. Self-restricts.
It's that's your meter, so to speak. It's 10-inch, 12-inch, whatever, 20-inch, 24-inch, whatever. Yeah.
That's an engineering question.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you were saying you have an interest in these properties over in this area?
We have nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with
it. Oh, it's in this area.
You have an investment.
That's where they're putting the Midas shop, I think, in here. Because they just built some kind of a bridge that goes over the top of Hall Creek.
Okay.
See, what we have a problem is when these two join up, and they join up back, actually they join up in this property over here, so this is not drawn correctly. And what happens is, this is two 60-inch pipes that go across the roadway here. This one was already breached. I know, because I happen to live on that property, and it was totally breached, 80 feet of it. It was a disaster. We had a leak, we didn't have a river. And this one here, right in here, with the two 60-inch pipes, what happens, all of this water that's coming down off of Buford Highway is now coming in here. And what happens is, it is destroying the riprap and all in there. And we feel as a community, we shouldn't have to be managing all of this. I mean, it makes sense to us that we're now being responsible for all the development that's going on here, because they're putting water in here. I don't know where the detention pond is. I don't see the plot from there. I think there's a big detention pond over here somewhere.
No, there's a...
I think so.
There's a temporary pond right in
the... Yeah, they had that big earthen group of thing, but I think there's a detention pond down in the center. I'm not sure. Because it does slope that way. It never really goes by your slope. Right? Your brain? Yeah. So, I would hope so. You got a high spot, you got big pumps. Yeah, so you know, we definitely all the interest, including yourself, we're all interested in making sure it's managed. It can only damage it here.
Yeah, you can see the flood zone here, see?
Well, this is actually, this is wetlands.
Wetlands, yeah. Wetlands.
The irony is that when the sewer line was installed,
it was right through it. It's actually right here.
It actually, the sewer line created it because they built up the berm, left it up.
Time-a-holes. We went through, they wanted a 40-foot easement and chop out every bit of the trees all the way down through here. And we negotiated with them to do a 20-foot, and they were able to leave some of the trees but still get their land done. They were brutal. They're brutal. It's condemnation. They just came in. The city of Cumming just came in and says, we're going to do it. We don't want to hear it.
Right, I wasn't around when all that happened.
Not your fault, yeah.
Yep. Now, didn't happen on my watch.
Are you Mr. Morgans? Morgans?
Morgans.
I think we were standing by maybe your son at the London airport a week and a half ago. Because my wife...
He wasn't there.
He wasn't? Well, there was somebody with Morgan Investments.
John Kidd.
We were waiting to get on the plane. Okay.
I know we're both my sons.
Okay. Okay. I live right there.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so
last night
we've got some trees, not evergreens. We've got a big magnolia tree right off our back porch. But then those other trees are fall, leaves are going into the spring. So we've got a 30-foot undisturbed buffer. We've got a wall that's about 6 or 8 foot.
That's what I thought when we were talking about.
But it only runs the length of this condo. And then there's people who walk up in here, walk up in here.
After the last year,
but of course, there's a very concerned lot of brush trees right in there, so that provides some barriers for that responsibility. There is a privet and things down on this property.
There's not much incentive for anybody to do that.
All of this, they're dumping more
to walk up through there.
The fence is not my concern. My concern is about the magnolias or something.
Let me call the engineering department here. I honestly don't know what we can do in the string buffer. My toilet tray just don't do anything.
Let me tell you what the county arborist told me.
We're still getting
I had him out
Greg
there.
Well, Greg Wallace, you see that?
Yes. He and I walked this whole property. And I asked him about this. Aren't we undisturbed by
okay.
He said, you can have a plan and put it together, and if you're joining property owner approves on it, then you can plant trees and magnolias, whatever, and that undisturbed buffer.
We're going to do now.
So,
okay.
Talk about this whole thing. This whole thing. I have to talk about this.
So you're right here. See,
so I live
tree.
Right here.
I'm Ethan, by the way.
Ethan, I'm Chuck.
Good to see you, Chuck.
No, I live right here. And I've got a lot of woods back here. Right here in this lot. So the way the water goes now, I had a pallet that I put where there's the stream where the water comes out. That pallet was here, and after the rainstorm, the pallet got pushed like 3/4 of the way across my property. A pallet, like a big pallet, it was just sitting there. It got picked up in
4 foot of water,
so it floated. Picked up and swept away.
He's got a bloody nose.
That takes bloody nose idea. So it takes a lot of water and force to pick up a pallet and move it. And I'm just going, you know what, if I get more water, I'm going to have to, I don't know what I'm going to do.
You won't get more.
Because I'm getting all their runoff.
I'll tell you, the law is nobody has a right to put more water on your property without your permission.
Okay. So, but if you put more impervious surface on there, and assuming, and I know you follow the code, but if this detention pond is here and we make more impervious surface here, what you're doing is you're collecting more water, not absorbing it.
That's true.
So when you're doing that, in fact, you will be putting more water that normally would have been absorbed into the earth.
That's true. But what
water
happened,
volume,
yes. But not at one time.
No, right, exactly. The meter,
it goes out,
right.
So that the flow, downstream flow.
Try to balance it. That's what the whole purpose of it is, to balance.
We were living here before this one in. Right, exactly. We didn't have any problem. And this one in. And now we got a real bad water. Now my neighbor down here, his backyard, he has a son named Jimmy, he's 11. He calls it, when it rains, he calls it the Jimmy River, because his 11-year-old son goes down and gets knocked down by the water going through his backyard.
Right through his
yard. What is it? Does it come through this?
Well, it's coming in.
Here, comes across here, and then comes right down in his yard.
This is Jim's house right here. Mm-hmm. You see this right here? There's his house back in there. I guess, it's right there, isn't it?
Well, that's Midland, and then this is Jim.
No, this is Englert, yeah. Right there. Okay, so what happens is the water comes across Chuck's, which is right here, and this is Jim Medlin's house.
Right.
It comes through here, because we walked it. Comes through here like this. It comes down, and all of a sudden, it just rushes through his yard, and it goes back, it tucks back into here. So something is diverting it now, so it's coming down through here, where it didn't come there before. So in other words, even in the normal rainy years, we never had this problem. Now all of a sudden,
it looks like it's well, coming into a...
Yeah, there's something that's going on over here that's caused something to divert.
Well, it's obviously enough that the blue line's showing coming this direction.
Well, yeah, we had...
There is, but that's not causing it.
Yeah, that,
so
we
I'm
thought that's
concerned
what it was.
I got a water problem now.
Yeah. A lot more water. We won't cause you more water. We won't cause you more water at one time. What we will do is stretch it out, and it'll be there for longer.
They're going to capture basically.
If you could give me some bamboo. I understand that grows a foot a day. Plant bamboo back there because it loves water. And it just set up a bamboo farm.
I'll tell you, have you thought about rice?
See, what we need to do, though, is we need to build a detention pond in his yard.
Yeah.
There you go.
To solve the network, well, the neighborhood problem.
Then you plant the rice.
And you farm it, so you make money on it. But you're going to have to hire locals.
We understand your concern. We've been hearing this has had issues for years. It's Chuck, right? I think what we ought to do is just work together and stay in contact so that you all know that Jim's doing what has to be done at the engineering department. And again, y'all don't know me from Adam's house cat, Jim, so I want y'all to feel that the county's required to do it.
Because of the stream on the boundary of the property, is this going to require an environmental impact study?
The hydrology study. Not before zoning.
Not a big,
you're going to have to use zoning for
studies. Really big federal deal.
I agree with that.
Well,
but you that's a term of art. It's a nice piece of property.
But you're almost up against federal wetlands.
Well, these are, the Corps of Engineers is the jurisdiction over this.
Yeah, that's what we were told.
But we have to do the hydrology study.
Oh, yeah.
But it's...
The Hall Creek goes right to our whole community.
We're very concerned.
Right.
Even if the county grants a variance to the county variance, then what would happen is then Jim still has to go to the state, and the state has to grant a variance, and then he still has to go to the Corps of Engineers, and they have to approve as well.
So. By the way, you remember that they were talking before, and as I recall, there is a lot of trees in here, and it says existing tree line.
That's right.
I remember that. And really, I mean, I know that in other situations, they were planting leylands or something like that, or something that would like water. And I don't think the county has ever given anybody a problem with that, because that actually absorbs some water.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
It doesn't. It doesn't add. It doesn't detract from the beauty. It doesn't add anything to the water quality. I don't know.
Those are rules that we don't make. But he's right. We can't do that without the variance.
Right. No, I agree with you. You're looking for a 10-foot off the 50.
County and state and federal.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah.
You know what kind of evergreens they planted at the entrance of the subway? They're not real.
No, they're not. They're better.
Is it an arborvita?
Or something like that. I think it could be arborvita.
The county has a list of things like cherry laurels, arborvitas,
right.
Hollies.
Yeah,
but something
this is leylands don't
this
like
This is an
water.
Evergreen.
Yeah, but it did a nice job to it. And they filled out very quickly.
The thuja.
Right down along here, they put them on both sides when we had the widening of the Georgia 20.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you what, they did a beautiful job. They got pretty darn big. But yeah, they did it, and it looks really
one
nice.
One died, but
and actually does block your
very well. What the county likes you to do is plant at least three species. That way you don't get a fungus on
them. Oh yeah, I agree with them, yeah. And I know there is a planting law where you have to put so many back in. And
that's
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And that's a pretty, that land there was pretty much just grasses from what I remember. I don't remember too much being.
That's what the area, this area was probably like 4 or 5 years old.
Oh yeah.
But that's what it showed us.
See, I thought that was always part of this property. I never knew that was a separate.
Well, at one point in time that was farmed.
I remember when there were animals in here. Oh yeah, and there was a house over here and there was a house over here.
Well, I'm talking about this property was farmed. And it looks like looking at it, it looks like farmland.
They were planting corn in there not too many years ago. Oh, absolutely. Alongside of this building right in here, there was all, they were plantings. Yeah. All right, well, thank you guys. We appreciate it.
Okay. We'll be in touch very
yeah,
soon.
Yeah, please. Thank
please
do.
Appreciate it. Good to see you.
Jay is our president of our association. Chuck's obviously a property owner. Sure. And I'm just here because of these other property owners that could not make it here. They're ones traveling back international. So,
yeah.
Just a skip.
A little John boat.
A Jimmy boat.
I guess.
Well, he's got his. He's got his.
If you dam it up, we're traveling.
I mean,
the trout ranch is gone. The trout ranch is gone.
The trout ranch is gone.
I used to fish that out.
Oh, yeah. It's gone. That's wiped out because of the new Chattahoochee Bridge. That's all gone. That's the Rainbow Ranch.
Yeah, that's money towards Chattahoochee. It used to be a rancher.
They stripped that stuff out. Yeah.
You drop your hook in the water, you can pull them out as fast as you put the hook in the water.
That's a project.
Run out.
It's pet trout.
Yeah.
Pet trout. Okay, thank you. Nice meeting you, Keith.
Thank you.
Thank you. I called your assistant and I said, well, she said, he's not here today. I said, well, I bet he will be. I think he's going to speak tonight. I said, well, just let him know that I'll be there. And she said, I'll do that.
No, okay. I've been in a CLE all day.
Yeah,
so.
That's okay.
No, glad you're here.
If we'll make sure we get you the information as well. Mm-hmm. It certainly helps to have a point of contact. You want us to contact Wendy?
That'd be great.
Okay. I'm actually required to, as long as I know you represent us. That's what I want to.
Yeah, Wendy does represent our
community. Keith is the primary representative for the neighborhood.
Okay. I'll send you emails, but if any phone calls, I'll definitely.
Sure.
Okay.
Thank you so
much. All right, good to see y'all.
Nice to see you. Ethan, do you want me to send you an email just so you'll have my email address?
Please.
Be glad to
you have my card?
Yeah.
They had a sign-in sheet. Did you sign in?
I did.
Okay, great.
I was just making sure we had each other, but thank you, Ethan, for reminding me. All right.
Okay, Knuckles is at the very top of the blue area.
That's Knuckles Road.
Yes.
Okay.
And this is Highway 20.